Good afternoon to all. Am I audible to you? Can anyone please respond?
Yes, sir, audible, sir.
Oh, my screen is visible to you.
Yes, sir, Java multi-threading.
Right, thank you. So, yeah, last class, we were discussing some of the features of Java programming. Of course, it also involves the object-oriented programming, the characteristics, and its implementations details. So in that process, we have halted it around the topic multi-threading. So before we move on to this topic, do you have any queries or do you have any doubts? Please let me know. For the topics, whatever we had discussed earlier. So I'll be continuing the topics from the multi-threading onwards. So prior to this, we have topics on the features of Java programming, Java language basics, packages and interfaces, exception handling. And today we'll see how the database management systems can be connected and how do we use it. So any queries on this last class discussions? Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Well, if you are not having any queries, then I will move forward. Multi-threading. So the advantage of having this multi-threading feature with the Java is that you can concurrently run various tasks so that you can minimize your execution time as well as you can utilize your resources efficiently. So Java itself is a multi-threaded programming language. So here, where you can run multiple tasks concurrently so that you can achieve some kind of parallelism and you can have some kind of distributed nature of computational things. So here, all this parallelism and distributed computing concepts can be easily realized with the help of this multi-threading concept. So if you look to the life cycle of a thread, so this multi-thread, the thread itself is a lightweight process. Of course, we have discussed in the last class, we little bit on what is that lightweight process is about. So if you see the thread can be in any one of these states at any point of execution. So initially, a thread which is going to be started with a new operator. So you are going to use the new operator to create a thread. So the new itself is a state where your a thread is getting originated or it is getting created. So once it is created, then now you are going to start that particular thread to perform its task. So a task is basically any programming instructions that you are trying to give it to the for an application to be solved. So basically your thread starts its execution, and once it starts, then it moves on to another state called as runnable state. So it means your thread is now in this runnable state, where it implies that the thread is meant for doing certain execution of a particular set of instructions. In a sense, a particular task is getting executed. So once the thread has moved from the creation, that is your new state, to the runnable state, and when the thread is performing its operations, that is performing its duty, that is basically executing its set of instructions. So while running, sometimes a particular process can be interrupted. In the sense is that process where certain programming instructions can be temporarily halted, or it can be terminated, or it can be in other sense, it is an interruption can be come across for that particular thread process to do its normal normal execution. So here, whenever the thread is in the running state, the thread, it means it is basically at a process itself. So when the process is in the running state, to be more specific, it is a lightweight process. So a process is in the running state. If some interruption comes, then obviously that thread, which is in the normal execution state, can go to a waiting state. In other terms, it can be the thread can temporarily halt for some time. So you can make the thread to sleep, or you can call it as a wait. So once you make them to temporarily halt for certain amount of time, then again you can revoke it, or you can continue your execution. Depending on your programming requirements, you can perform the application accordingly. So application execution performs based on how the thread is going to made use of. So sometimes after completing its task, the thread can move to terminate state, or you can call it as a dead state. So once it has completed its execution, then we say that the thread has moved to the end of execution state. It is called as a dead state. Or sometimes while we're waiting for the thread to resume its job or resume its task, it may be indefinitely, it may have to wait for certain amount of time, then the thread can also move from your waiting state to the termination state. So this is basically a life cycle. So the thread can be in any one of these state during its execution process once you use it in your program. So here, as I mentioned in the last class, there are two ways to use the thread concept in the programming aspects. So one way is to try to directly extend the thread class. In other sense, your subclass can inherit the thread class itself. So that is one way. And the second way is sometimes you can use your runnable interface. So that's what, when your thread, when it is after it started, you can use the runnable interface to complete its execution, or to use the thread process. So the both the ways, let us see the program. And so of course, the step one is when you extend the thread class, basically the thread class itself, that is the base class, or you are called as a parent class, the thread class itself has got a method, a run method. So here, let us see what that run method, and how do you write the code, and how it is getting overriding. So it means you are changing the logic of that existing run method. So let us see. I hope you have installed your Eclipse with your JDBCs and with your JSPs. So from last class, I directed you to install these software tools so that you can practice and you can try to appreciate and understand how the things goes on. So let me just show you. This is Eclipse IDE, Integrated Development Environment, of course the latest version. So you can get that IDE environment like this. Of course, if you have IntelliJ or if you have other IDEs, it's acceptable. You can start using it, provided you are a Java JDK and your JRE has properly set up in your respective systems. So we'll start with the multi-thread programming, the multi-thread demo. So here, let me just show here. So this one example, basically, I hope you are able to see the my programming screen. Hello.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So this particular program, I will try to make sure some interaction is going on. So I will ask one by one for you to have an explanation for this, so that at least some interaction goes on. Yeah, so Praveen, am I audible to you? V Praveen.
Sir, yes, sir.
Yeah, so can you please tell me how your Java program gets executed here? What is the start of your program?
From main.
From the main, very good. So,
sir, can you maximize it?
One second. I'm just adjusting my screens here, right. Okay, I hope you are able to see the program.
Sorry, increase the font size.
Increase the font size, sir.
Okay. So once I started discussing, some of you already left. Well, what about now?
Okay, sir, now it's okay. But can you maximize this, the Eclipse? Okay, sir. Okay, sir, it's
okay. Right. So, yes, I just keep on the right side because some of them are still joining the session, so I hope they are okay. Right, fine. Yes, Praveen, so your execution starts from the main, and that main method,
yes, sir.
Yes, is in the class
test thread.
Yes, test thread. So what is happening in the main method?
A new object is created, like test thread demo one.
No, what is the object name?
T1.
Yes, T1 is the object name. T1 is of what type?
Thread demo.
Yes, thread demo one.
Thread demo one.
Okay. Now, Vinod Kumar, can you please tell me what is exactly happening with this T1 object? Vinod, am I audible? Yeah.
Yes.
So
we created a reference T1, the demo, and it will, as we call the start method, it will start when the.
No. Can you hold on? Please, it is not yet completed. So T1 object. This is an object. This is a class variable. You can call it as a class variable, or this you can call it as an object. This object is of type thread demo one. So once this object is instantiated, it means it is getting created, it is invoking a constructor. Which constructor it is invoking?
Thread demo one.
Yes, thread demo one is the constructor. And what is the parameter here, or what is the argument you see?
It's string, sir. String type thread one.
It is a string type, and the value is
thread one.
Thread one. So where the control goes now? So the control goes to the, because this object is of type thread demo one. You have a class here. The definition of the class is class thread demo one. But what is actually happening? Class thread demo one. It is extending the base class, the actual class. This is one way of creating the thread. So the base class here is, what is the base class?
Thread class, sir.
Yeah, thread class. So here this thread demo one has got a constructor here. So this is the definition of the constructor. So yes, next person, Tawab, can you please tell me what this constructor is trying to do here?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what the constructor thread demo one is performing, or what is trying to do here? Thread demo one.
Issue the string name, sir.
So the thread demo one, once the object is getting created, it has passed on the string variable, and that string variable is basically a string itself is. The string variable is name here, and it gets a value. So what is that value here? Thread one. And that value, that name value, has been given to your another string variable, which is passed on to your temporary variable thread name, and that thread name value has been displayed here. It means, it implies that once the thread is created, the corresponding name of that thread is been displayed here. Is it okay? Yes. So now comes to Swati. So please tell me, Swati, now what happens once this object is created? The object T1 has been created, then the object T1 is created with the name thread one. Press. So one, once this statement is over, then what happens next?
With the same object, we are calling start method.
Yes, the same object, that is your T1 object, is calling the start method. Because once the, after creation is over, if you see the if you see that material, you can get that meaning here. Once see here the life cycle of the thread. So the life cycle of the thread, once the thread is been created, so you have to issue the command start method, and once it is, the start method is invoked, you are going, the thread is going to a runnable state here. So here the thread one is now calling a method start. So what is actually happening in the start method, can you please tell me?
So first it is calling some print statement that it is starting the thread, and there is a variable called t which is declared in the beginning. We are checking whether it is null or not.
Yes, what is the type of that variable? The type of the variable is a thread type only.
Thread type.
And if you see the access privilege, what is the access privilege here?
Private.
Private. What is the access privilege private indicates?
It is only available in that particular class.
Only in the scope of this variable T is going to be available only in this particular class. Yes, private. And the class name is thread demo one. Right. Now what happens is, initially, because this is itself, the thread itself is a starting thread, it is initially it is null here, right? If t is equal to null initially, so then yes, then what we have to do, that thread t is equal to null, yes, this t is now getting a new value, that is a new thread is created, that is the thread name is the thread one, and the thread one is getting started. That is the method. This is a actual method. The thread, the object is calling this particular start method to start its execution. So now once, okay, now Suvam, can you please tell me, once this thread has started its execution, what is going to happen here?
Yes, sir.
Once the thread has started its execution, then you come to your, once it is started its execution, you come to a state called runnable. And what method is going to run here? In the runnable state,
the run method.
Run method is going to run. So that is the run method. You know, you are coming to this run method here. So the definition of this run method is this. So this is the run method. The name of this method is already existing in the base class called thread. Please remember, run is a already a method which is existing in the base class thread. So you are giving a new definition here. So this process is called as
overriding.
Yes, please remember this is basically overriding. It is not overloading. Overloading is what is overloading? A function signature. Please remember the function signature is going to be the different. That is overloading. This is overriding is also one type of polymorphism where you are going to define your own logic here. So right next to Sumit, please tell me what is the logic of this run method? What is written in the run? What does run method do? Yes, please.
Sir, it is printing running thread name, and
so the it is not running thread name. The thread name. What is the thread name? Thread name is thread one, and the thread one is in the running state. That's what you have put it in the print statement. Fine. Then
we are initializing I to 4, and till it becomes 0, we are running it. Again, we are printing thread name, and we are displaying the value of I. And
okay.
Then
okay,
we are giving a sleep time of 50 milliseconds, I think.
Yes, thread dot sleep is made to 50 milliseconds. So the I value is going to be displayed for every 50 millisecond, and all these logical statements are put in a block called try block. Please see here carefully. So exception handling is also taken care. Please remember. So there's an exception handling mechanism because you are executing these instructions, and sometimes when you are executing this task, this thread can have an interruption. Or somebody can have something, some other programming task can interrupt this thread. So if at all somebody is interrupting, then you need to catch that person or the catch that particular point where that interruption has been raised. So that's why you are putting all these instructions in a try block for executing those instructions logically. And if at all there is something wrong which is going to happen, then you can catch that exception and you can display that exception here, whatever the exception has been raised here. So that's what good. And this program, let us see how this program is going to give, and similarly, okay, now. So then fine. The next person, Niru. Yeah. Nirupamma. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please. Can you please tell me what happened after the thread one is, it is doing its task now. What happened? What are the other instructions that are there in the main now?
After that, we create a new thread.
Yes, after thread T1, yes, after the thread one that is T1, then we have created a new another object. So yes, that object is this object is also of what type?
Sir?
This T2 is of what type? T2 object.
T2 is an object of type thread demo one.
Yes, thread demo one. The same thing, thread demo one. T2 is an object. It is some space is also created. The space includes the variables and the methods. So here the variables are again the variables are your the thread name. These are the same variables names and the method. This is also thread demo one, but this time the thread demo one. This thread name. What is the thread name you have? The thread name is basically your the thread two.
Thread two.
Yes, thread two. So similarly, again once the thread has been created. The thread has been created, then you are going to have the next process as t2.start. So t2.start, you are going to, again, the same process is applicable, t2.start, then the t, the value of the t corresponds to t2 and it is starting its process. And once they started the thread, it goes to the, again, the running state. And it is also, this thread also is trying to print the value of I, it's starting from 4 with an interval of 50 milliseconds. And if at all this thread also gets some interruptions, that also you can catch it. That's what your try catch block is been given here. And that corresponding values are also been going to be displayed. So let us see how this program runs. So this is what you are. So here this method, you are running two tasks here, which are basically thread one and thread two. So both the threads are trying to display some values in this program, but you can as well give some other logic. And you can perform those logical operations accordingly on those particular thread tasks. So let me just run this program. And you can see it is on the console. Yes, it very quickly it has completed its execution because the values are very slow. And if you can give the counter value very high, then obviously you won't get it. So that corresponding instruction that you that are executed are creating thread one, then you are starting the thread one, then followed by creating thread two, then followed by starting thread two. You are once the thread is created, then the corresponding thread has been started. Then the running thread one has been. I hope you are able to see the output on the console window.
Yes, sir.
So these are the values 4, 3, 2, 1 of each thread with an interval 50 milliseconds in between. Of course, that wait time will be very less because I am running it on a very high processor. So it will be that minimal time is not to be counted. So this is one way to write the multi-threading program in Java. So let us see the other way now. There is another method to implement the thread concept. What is that another method to implement the thread concept? So if you are going to use the runnable interface, so here, if you see here carefully, we are using the interface runnable. That's why we are having the keyword implements. So the keyword implements is basically pointing to the interface called runnable. So in the previous case, if you might have seen, we have extended the thread class. That's basically you are inheriting. So what is this? What is the difference between a class and an interface, please? Next person, Raghavendra.
Sir, in interface, all methods are abstract, sir. In class there can be abstract methods or complete methods, concrete methods.
So similarly here so you can see this particular runnable demo is trying to implement the interface runnable. So basically, the instructions are almost the same. So your execution starts from the main. You are creating an object R1 of type runnable demo. Same thing, and R1 is getting start. So the states of the threads are going to be the same. So your start process, your start method gets executed here. And once the start method completes, started, then the run method does its job. The same logic here we are keeping. Please remember, we have kept it in the exception handling. Please see, always now from now onwards, you should have a practice of writing exception handling for every program of the Java and other programs that you write it in, either in the Python or whatever it may be. So the same thing. So this is a constructor which you have used it. Now the actual question comes here. Sheikh Dawood, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Can you please tell me now, there are two ways to implement the thread concept.
Extending the thread class.
Extending the thread class, very good. The other way is?
Extending the runnable method.
Don't say extending the runnable method. You have to use the word implements, because not the runnable method, it is a runnable interface, in fact. So runnable is an interface, not it is a method. Please don't confuse it. The terminology is most important here. So you are implementing the runnable interface here. Now the actual question is, what is the difference between these two? Extending the thread class and implementing the runnable interface. Under what situations you have to use extend thread class? Under what situations you have to use use the runnable interface?
So if you want to have abstract things, then we can have go for an interface. Where if we are using directly the methods of the thread class, then we can go for extending the class.
Of course, we have to use the methods of the thread class. You have used it. You to some extent, you said that if your methods are not having definition, then you can use the runnable and otherwise the thread class. But still, I'm expecting a very very accurate answer. Can you try it, or shall I go with the other person?
I'm trying, so I'm not getting.
Yeah. Yeah, not getting. Don't worry. We will come to know now. Next person, Taraka Nada.
Yes, sir.
Yes, please. So, what can be the difference between extending the thread and implementing the runnable interface? What may be the differences?
Sir, there will be method implementations. More method implementations will be there in thread class, sir.
More method implementations. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And then while coming to a runnable interface, we have only the run method, sir. So that too, it was not implemented. So we need to.
We need to implement it. We need to write the definition here.
Yes, sir.
No, that is not the correct. It's not that more methods are to be implemented than we use the extended thread class. No. So, okay, I will put the question in another way. Can we create an object of runnable interface? Anybody?
No, no, sir.
Very good. Tarakananda, you have given the answer. Very good. So, Sheikh Dawood, the same thing. I'm putting the question for you also. Can we create an object of runnable interface?
No, sir.
No. So, you can create an object of only class type. Class. Yes or no?
Yes, sir. Class type.
Yeah, you can create a class. So, class should be there. That is what your blueprint of the object is. That's what your data abstraction is. So, once you create an object, what exactly happens?
It will get attributes and methods.
Very good. It will get the, that's what your encapsulation. So whatever the attributes and methods of the class are there, it means what? It is getting attributes and methods means you are just very near to the answer. It means what? Very direct answer. Just one word answer or two words at the maximum.
Instance.
Instance. Okay, I am again asking, what do you mean by instance there? Yes, Muhammad Salman.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, can you please now, what exactly happens when you create an object? When an instance of an object is created, what happens?
Memory is allocated, sir.
Exactly. Very good. The right word and the right meaning. Very good. Many, memory is allocated. So now the question comes here. Whether when you yourself cannot create an object of runnable interface, so memory is not allocated when you are going to use the implements runnable interface. So now I have given the hint. Now tell me when we should prefer for extending the thread class. And when we can prefer for implementing the runnable interface. Yes, Muhammad Salman.
I think extending thread class is generally create object unique object with respect to each instantiation, sir. But yes. In runnable
unique thread, object, please remember unique object. Along with the object, you are going to allocate some space also. Please remember.
Yes.
For each object. Whenever you create objects, some spaces are allocated. But whereas runnable interfaces, you are not going to make use of that spaces. You are just implementing the run method itself.
Yes.
So here, yes, that is a reason. Yes. You are right. So here, that is the advantage of having the runnable interface where there is a space crunch is there for our applications. Then you can directly use this implements runnable interface rather than extending the thread class to create the objects and allocate the spaces and make use of the threads to run in that particular spaces. The object spaces will be used by those thread class. So instead of to overcome that one, you can use the runnable interface. So you can minimize that object space utilization and you can have it. So I'm just executing this program and you can see this is an output, the same thing, the output. Of course, the logic is the task is remaining the same. You get the output also almost the same. So these are the multi-threading that is the advantage of having the feature of multi-threading in the Java, where two concurrent programs or multi-programming or multi-task can be achieved by utilizing these thread concepts. Of course, very simple example only here. When you do in the projects and when you apply for more case studies, we will get it in a more better way. So now next, moving to the JDBC, Java Database Connectivity. So Java Database Connectivity, what is JDBC stands for? Java Database Connectivity. So for this one, what I use here is I already installed a WAMP server. So this WAMP is basically Windows, Apache, MySQL and PHP. So you can see it on my screen. WAMP server has been installed, and you can see it on the browser. The database of that particular. So in order to have understand the features of Java Database Connectivity, you should have a database server which is running in the background of your application. So this is one particular database. There is basically MySQL database. So here I just prepared one particular database with some one table only, of course. So I hope you are able to see the screen, the database and the tables.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So here I just created one table called employee. So this employee table, if you see the schema of this employee table, you see here you have an ID, name and a salary. These are the three fields: employee ID, employee name, and the corresponding salary. And of course, if you see the records, as of now there are only two records. I just tested for the sample purpose the JDBC is executing or not. So here, let us have an introduction to JDBC. Then we'll come back to this. 1 second. Yes, so JDBC stands for Java Database Connectivity. Basically, it is a standard Java API for your database independent connectivity between the Java programming language and a wide range of databases. So wide range means there are several databases available in the market for you, like your Oracle is one database. You have SQL, SQL Server, Microsoft's SQL Server is there. And you have other databases which are supporting the open database connectivity features. So you can connect your Java application. If you see the architecture here, so your Java application, that is a program. So through the program or through that particular Java application, you can connect to several other databases. So you know what is a database is. So here you are going to have a collection of your data, which is in an organized manner. It can be a relational database. It can be a non-relational database too. So, but we are now looking for an example in with respect to the relational database management system. So here, different types of databases can be connected. But if you see in between your Java application and the actual databases, you have certain software entities here. So what are these software entities? One is your JDBC API, application programming interface. So through in your program, through the Java program, you are going to interact with your databases, which have been connected to retrieve or to fetch, means to retrieve or to manage or to control your data with respect to various applications. So in order to interact with these data, your application programming interface provides some other software tools. So you require the JDBC drivers, which are meant for managing these databases as well as trying to provide some connectivity. So here, this JDBC driver, what is a driver? A driver is nothing but basically a software tool which will help you to, in this case, it will help you to connect to various with respect to the database that you are going to use it. and make them utilization means the data can be passed from your databases to your application and from your applications to your databases. So it is, can be to and fro. It means from your program to your actual physical storage device, from your physical storage device to your program, and of course to the other applications and other entities. So in order to support this movement of data from your application to data source or for your data and from your data to your applications, you usually require this JDBC drivers, so the softwares, basically the software tools that will help you to connect and try to fetch and apply that various database operations on them. Of course, this manager is make sure that if you are using multiple databases which are connected to your application, then how do you manage them? Of course, that software tool is going to take care of. But in our example, in the demo, what we are going to see is we are going to connect to only one particular database, that is your MySQL database. We'll connect it from our Java and we'll see how the program can be written and how it can be used of. So of course, whenever you make use of these interfaces, these classes, and the corresponding programming statements that you prepare for your SQL statements to be executed with your Java, and the responses that you get it from your databases in terms of result sets. And of course, during this data movement or you are trying to connection, you may have certain exceptions, and how do you handle those exceptions? All these features has to be incorporated in your program. That is the basic things that you need to understand before you try to apply your JDBC concepts onto fetching and the managing the data onto your data with your Java applications. So what I have done is on my computer, on my laptop, I have already installed this WAMP stack. WAMP stands for Windows, Apache, MySQL, and PHP. It is a combination of several software tools. It is a stack of these tools to basically for your web applications and so on and so forth. So you can as well have other, you can as well have only database server too. That is also been sufficient. But in addition to the database server, what you are seeing is a PHP MyAdmin. It is like a kind of IDE integrated. It's not integrated development element, but a graphical user interface. In fact, this graphical user interface will help us to interact with your database. And without writing SQL statements, you can use these commands and you can use this interface options to either to create your databases or to create your tables. And of course, you are all DDL and DML commands. If you are not sure about those commands, the SQL commands, if you don't want to execute it, you can as well run those statements here. If you are comfortable with the command execution, SQL commands, as well you can type the programming instructions, the SQL instructions here. You know what is select, insert, update, delete, and like similar commands. You can write your own programs, nested queries, and of course, and other things all through this particular interface. So once you prepared yourself, then go to the program. So let us see the program here. And of course, you need to include one library called MySQL connector, because this is the connector. It is like your driver tool, which will connect your Java program to your actual MySQL database, which is running in the background of your applications. So here, the program is something like this. So hope you are able to see the program.
Yes, sir.
So, all right. So, just let me just arrange the screen, then I will get back to you. Yes, please. So we have stopped at Mohammed Salman is over. Next, Banusri. Banusri, are you audible? Am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Is it? Oh, sorry. Okay. So now, can you see the program?
Yes,
we are trying to see one small demo on the JDBC connectivity.
Yes, sir.
So your program starts from which particular method? Hello. Banusri, is there any problem from at your end?
No, sir. Yes, okay.
Yes, your program, you are starting your program from your main method here. What is exactly happening here? Can you please tell me now? So your main method has started in line number 6, and the class name is something like inserting the values. Okay, now what is our next statement? Immediate next statement. Once your program starts executing,
the connection is said to be null.
Yes, there is one object here. So that object name is, what is the name of the object?
C-O-N.
This is a class variable, connection variable, which is equivalent to null. If you are not giving a null, then how usually you instantiate an object, or how an object is getting created?
Connection form is equal to new connection.
New operator, you will be using new. So new. Please remember, all of you, whenever you use new operator, it means you are allocating some memory. That's what your object is getting created with some memory. The memory, how much memory means? It depends on what are the attributes or what are the methods that are present in that class definition. So it depends on that much memory. So here we are not creating, we are not allocating some memory to this, but we have initialized this object variable to null. And this object variable is of what type? Yes, yes, please. Next person, Aishwarya. Kulshrestha,
yes, sir. This object is of connection type.
Yes, this objection is of a class of type connection. So this connection class is present from in which particular package? Because this is not user defined class. This is a built-in class, and that class is defined in the package called sql.star. In this particular, you can import this. That's what we have imported this. So java.sql.star, obviously all these classes and methods which are available in this SQL package, all those things are going to be included here. And please remember, we also defined our own package here. Our package name is, our user defined package name is?
DB demo,
yes. And this is java.sql.star is the built-in packages. And DB demo is our user defined package. So now we are importing this built-in package into a program such that these, you will see the following set of instructions and the statements which are going to be used and which are belonging to this particular package called SQL. Right. So what is the next statement, please? Yeah, this object variable is created without any space and without any member variables and methods, but it has been initialized with null, so that now later this object variable is going to point. It is going to point, it is like a pointer now. A pointer which is going to point to certain place, that we will see where it is going to point. So what is the next one?
String URL. URL is being assigned a string value.
Yes, there is a variable now. This variable URL is of type string. And what is the value of this one?
JDBC MySQL.
Yes, JDBC colon MySQL colon / localhost colon 3306. So this is a syntax, please remember all of you, a syntax, you are connecting the JDBC, Java database connectivity. This is the driver, which is connecting to a database. The database is MySQL, and the database is running on the local server of my computer. That's what we call it as a local host. And the database can be accessed through the port number 3306, which is the default port number for you. The MySQL database server, which is running locally in your computer. That's what those are the settings. So there is a syntax you need to specify clearly what database you are connecting and where is the database located on the local system and the corresponding port number, which is open for your data operations to be performed. Okay, now, yes, please. Yes, the next variable is db, and db is another temporary variable which I have taken to specify a name for your my database. If you have seen here, there is a database. I already created the database here. So the database is basically, let me just show you the database name. So the database name which is there on the database is JDBC demo. This is the database. You can see that there are some few databases are there. I have just created one database temporarily called JDBC underscore demo. In the database, I have one table here. That name of the table is employee. Please remember this. Okay, now another variable is there here. That is the driver. So that is the driver which you are going to make use of. So this is a syntax for that JDBC driver. com.mysql.cj.jdbc.driver. So that is a syntax that is just you need to provide. Of course, it is in the reverse. You can understand that how we try to connect to your qualified domain names and so on and so forth. Okay, yes, now coming to the next instruction. So for this driver, for the class, whatever you are connecting here, you are connecting to the database with this driver. That is a syntax you are calling. So your class dot for name the driver, whatever the specification you are using. If you are connecting to Oracle, if you are connecting to MySQL, different drivers will be there. I'm connecting to MySQL. I'm just connecting this one. Now you see the connection variable. This connection variable is connecting, is getting the connection using this driver manager class. Your method get connection method. You are in the parameters for this get connection is the URL. So you need to specify the database, where it is located, and which port number you need to specify, plus as well as the database in which you are trying to access the database, which is present locally here. And along with this database, this database has to be accessed by a particular user. Usually the root, the administrator of the database is a root here. And of course, I have not given any password for this root database here. So that's why it is null here. So you need to specify the username who can access this particular, who has got privileges. The user who is usually the admin has got all the privileges of that database. Here the user is root, who is the admin of that particular database itself, is trying to access. That's what the entire connection string. So this is what the connection string, entire connection string. And that's the information which you have seen here. So the connection string has got very important thing that you are trying to connect to your database from your making. You see, that is what the important step here, making a connection to your database. This is the important step, making a connection to your database through a connection string that will always will help you. So like this in Python, in PHP or in Java, whatever you do, obviously there is going to be a connection string for you. So once the connection string is established and the connection object, that our connection object variable, the pointer is pointing to the database where it is located. So what you need to do is you are now having a create statement. So this create statement basically is tries to prepare your object variable, a statement, so that the statement can be executed on the database. So that statement is basically you are going to use this creation statement. The statement itself is st. So with this, using the st, you prepare your statement, and the prepared statement is something like this: insert employee ID, name, and the salary, and the corresponding values of that. And of course, I'll just change the name to something like this for you. So I hope you know the DML commands in your database. If you already learn this database commands, then this statement is going to be very simple for you. Only thing is, when you're writing through Java, you are going to have a prepared statement. That's what these statements are, very executable prepared statements. And that corresponding println statement also, you get it here. And once that connection statement is prepared, you are going to execute that. So what is that execute SQL command? That SQL command is insert employee, insert that is into the employee table to this particular corresponding attributes, and there is this corresponding values. So let me just run this and we'll refresh it and see of course, these all these statements before I run, just let me complete this explanation. Before you run this, so make sure that all these executable statements are always put in the exception handling mechanism with the try block. And if at all, see, you can see there is an exception here called SQL exception. If sometimes your database is not providing connection, or sometimes the existing database or the table is not there, or there is some issue with your SQL statements or your SQL database connectivity, that exceptions can be easily caught. You can display it. So you have a multiple catch here, you see. Sometimes you, if there is only exception related to your SQL statement, this particular catch statement can catch that particular exception and it can be raised. If at all you have some other exceptions on your IO or your data transfer, those exceptions also can be caught and you can try to find out. So here in this case, you caught, once you caught that one, you can try to print that stack trace. It will all display what error it is, or what is the exception, what is the problem that has been raised for that exception which has come, so that you can correct it in a better way. So that you can trace that particular stack and you can try to minimize your errors or eliminate your errors accordingly. So here, let me just execute this program. And of course, I have already written this program, because if you, I start typing it, it will simply kill our time, and that's why just for demo purpose. So yes, you can see this is the statement. It is the values inserted. So let us see the table here in the background, and employee table is this. So now you see there are three records here, NKS1 and 5000. You can see the values. So how you can be just connecting to a database, a JDBC, and connecting to the database and trying to perform some. Of course, in the example, I have shown you only insertion. You can as well write your statements here. So you can also create the database by using the creation statement. Create. How do you create it? Of course, at least tell me what statement or what command do you use to create a table? DDL command.
Truncate.
Sorry?
Truncator.
No. I'm not asking about how do you get the, how did you get to this word truncate actually? See, the create, there is a create command itself, the SQL command.
Data definition language.
Yeah, data definition language command. You can use the create command for creating it. Suppose you want to alter the table, changing the attributes, you can use the alter command. You want to update some values, you can use the update. So only thing is the same process here. Instead of this insert into employee, if you want to update the employee, you just write the corresponding SQL query. Whatever the query you write it here, that corresponding query is going to be executed here. So you need not write everything. Means you, again, anything you want to perform any operation, please remember you need to specify. You need to specify the connection string. You need to prepare a executable statement, and you need to execute that query into that executable statement. So all these steps are going to be compulsory if you are to interact with your database through Java programming. So this is just the basic things about how you can connect to a database and do some database operations. Of course, the example is only just to insert. You can as well do some updations, deletions, altering the tables, creating the tables, and so on and so forth. So if you are going to, provided you, there is a connection is established, please remember. Yes, any queries here, please? Any queries up to now? Database connectivity? So the basic information is enough, and if you can try to practice the program, what I'm giving to you, that should also be sufficient to get an understanding about this multi-threading and Java database connectivity. So please let me know if you have any queries at this moment. Otherwise, I will just pause for 10-15 minutes and we'll continue with introduction to servlets. Yes, please. So we'll continue our discussion with introduction to servlets. It is 3:10, so I will connect to you back at 3:25. So if you have any doubts on multi-threading and JDBC, please let me know. I'll try to clarify you. So we'll connect it back again at 3:25, just 10-15 minutes. You just take some relax for 10-15 minutes, then I will continue the discussions with servlets.
Okay, sir. Sir, I suddenly used a truncate word because I heard like what is used for delete purpose. Instead of create, I heard like create, delete, so that's the reason
I created. I understand, no problem, no worries. See, even delete itself is a drop is there. Instead of delete,
yes, sir.
No worries. So yes, we'll connect it back at 3:25 and we'll continue. Thank you. Welcome back, and let us continue our discussion. So I hope you are able to see the Jamboard, the white screen.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and I hope you are also able to access those Jamboard, right? Only two of them have now connected, Sumit and Mohammed Salman. What about others? Those that are present in the session, you can also as well join to this. Yep. Okay. So to understand the need of the servlets and what servlets are and how do we use it, so let me just give you some small illustration here. So assume that course for writing also it is a little bit difficult here.
No, sir, use that text box and type it.
Yeah, that looks like okay.
No, below that, second last.
Yeah, this, but still. Okay, anyway, that will be fine. Right. Now, assume that you have a client here and you have a server. So, what exactly you are trying to do here is, you are sending some request from the client to the server. Right? So what type of request do we send? Usually, yeah, we already discussed this long back. What means, how do you send your request? Okay, I'll put the question in another way. How do you send the request? Yes, please.
Using client server protocol.
Using?
Client server protocol.
Using client server protocol. So what is the client server protocol, may I know? What is that client server protocol is?
HTTP.
HTTP protocol is just, yeah. Basically, yeah, RESTful API. You can use your representational state transfer, the RESTful API. So you will use either your GET or your POST or other commands, so that from your web browser, using your GET command, your request has been sent to your server. So what does the server do now? Server will try to respond to your, server is going to give some responses. So the responses will be either if suppose the the client is trying to get some information as a web page or whatever it may be, some resources like your web pages. So if those web pages are there, if they are present on the server, you get some information. Suppose I am looking for something like so here from the client, you send a request to get some myinfo.html file. If that HTML file is present on the server, then obviously you get a response from the server that the so-and-so information is available. And of course, you get the status and you get the corresponding information that needs to be accessed or to be displayed on the client. So basically an HTML page or an information is going to be passed on to the requested client. And assume that if this particular myinfo.html, if this is a static page, what do you mean by static pages? Yes, please.
Content is fixed, not
changed. Yes, content. The content of the web page is already fixed in the sense that there is not going to be changed. And right. So now assume that this, so far, okay, this is what you have seen from the previous any web server. So these web server means your web application server, where your resources and your contents and your information, which is available on a particular computer, which is connected across the internet, means it is available on some other place, and you try to get the request from your browser sitting on a computer or a mobile phone or another system. From that particular server, you try to get the information onto your place, onto your system. Assume that, let me have something here. Five, and assume that there is some other value here. Right. And you have an OK button. All right. So the user from the client side has entered some numbers, whatever it may be, some two numbers, three numbers, whatever it may be, and he just pressed the submit button. What is going to happen now? Can anybody tell me?
It's answered.
Can you please repeat, Amma Banusri? I could not hear your voice.
A request is sent to this server.
Yes, 5, 6, and assume that I write something like add instead of submit button. I'll write add button. Assume that. Submit button, or it can be an add button, whatever it may be. So the request is going to send to the server. So what server will do now? Yes, please. What server is going to do? User has entered two numbers and he has clicked one button. Basically, the button is a submit button. What user is going to do? Anyone?
That addition logic has to be written. in server.
Addition logic has to be written in server.
Yes, sir.
Can you use this? Yes, please. The addition logic has to be there on the server. Then only the server can give the response. But if that addition logic is not there, what the server is going to do? Yes, please. Anyone?
Return and
error. Because usually when you send your get and post methods, for a client trying to access some information, some of the HTML information, and if the HTML information is available, you get the responses. Even if that HTML information is not available, you get the response stating that 404 file not, means page not found, page not available. Like that, web informations do get it. But suppose sometimes your client client is sending some request that needs to be processed, the data has to be processed. The data has to be computed on the server, and what that logic or the logic or that information that is not available at the server, then what the server is going to do? That is very critical point. And that is point number one. Point number two here, the second point what needs to you have to understand is, if suppose you are requesting some information which is coming from the client, which is client is trying to request it, and that pages are not available on this server, not only data processing, but if suppose that page is itself is not available, page maybe that can be any page, actually it need not be only some other pages here, and that pages has to be dynamically created in the sense that the server has to prepare those pages dynamically depending on the request of the client. Since those pages are not available on the server will do certain kind of certain kind of computational thing. So some kind of things are going to be performed by the server here. So now let me just add something here. So we have something here. What we do is we have the server. So in the server, we have something like, we have something like a compute engine. Or that is a compute engine, basically it computes. Not only compute, you can do some kind of processing here. So this processing basically is going to happen on this, at the server side, with certain features, in fact. With certain features means what the server has to do with these inputs that are coming to the server. And and one more point that you need to have an understanding is that basically you are trying to, before we move on, can you tell me what are the different server side scripting languages that you have known so far? Or what are the different programming languages? Those programming languages which, see here carefully, these .html files is basically an hypertext markup language. It is just an hypertext. So if suppose some user is giving, trying to give some inputs and that data has to be processed, so you cannot use this markup languages to process the data. It means these compute engines cannot use this markup languages to process the data. They have to use other programming languages or other scripting languages to process the data or to prepare the data or to provide the data that is not available on the server, so that that can be served means it can be giving the response that this is your response for the request that is made by the client. So you need certain programming languages. So there are different programming languages, such as, can you tell me different programming languages which are used at the on the server side to process the data or to prepare the data and to give the responses to the computed data for the different requests that are made by the client? Can you tell me what are those programming languages?
PHP.
Yes.
JavaScript,
yes. Python, Java. Yes. See, PHP. ASP. You have Ruby. Of course, you JavaScript to some extent on the server side.
Node.js.
Yes. Python. Yes. Very good. So Node.js. So like this, you have different programming languages and different frameworks, of course, different servers, which will try to prepare some data which is not existing. That is what you are looking for, a dynamism, dynamic web pages or dynamic contents, contents which can be ad hocly prepared. Dynamic values can be generated based on the request from different clients. So these type of programming languages, of course, can you tell me what is the difference between these five? At least you have mentioned some five. PHP, Hypertext Preprocessor. What does PHP stands for? Hypertext Preprocessor. What is it is used for basically? No idea. Yes, please. Of course, PHP is also used for your web services and for your web contents to be processed by on the server side. Why different server side scripting languages have come into picture? Why we do not have only one type of server side scripting language? Of course, depending on the user requirements, depending on the applications, various applications, depending on various usages, we have different types. Of course, that is one comparison. But I'm looking for some other comparison here. What can be this PHP, please? Hypertext preprocessor. Hypertext. Please remember hypertext. So, what is hypertext again? Am I audible to you?
Yes, sir, audible, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Please tell me what is hypertext preprocessor. The names itself will give you the answer. What is hypertext? At least tell me.
Hypertext means, sir, that we go through that pages, that reference page that we want to.
So, Tawab has given a good answer. Yes, it is going to a particular page through the hyperlink or to the hyper reference. So you can use your anchor tag and you can link from one web page to another web page, going to another web page. But still, of course, it's not a complete answer, I suppose. I'm expecting something else. And any other views, please? Hypertext. Hypertext, which is not an ordinary text, in simple words. Which is not an ordinary text means, what is that special text? What is that speciality on that hypertext? Speciality means, what is that uniqueness or what is the characteristics of that text? Yes, please.
Sir, there will be a structure, sir. The text will contain a structure which can that machine can understand.
Of course.
Trying to fetch the content of web.
Yes, Vinod, can you please repeat? Your voice is very low.
Actually, dynamically fetches the web content, or we can say it refers to another web pages.
Yeah, referring to other web pages, dynamically, dynamic contents can be accessed. Banusri, you are trying to say something?
It is machine readable, sir.
Hypertext is machine readable? Are you sure? What do you mean by machine readable?
I mean, it's understandable in both the ends. So, that's
so machine means understandable by the machine, hypertext means? No, you are going very out of the scope, Amma. Your HTML tags, what are these tags? Tags means hypertext only, basically. I have given one more clue, tags. What does the tags refer to? It is referring to hypertext. So go to your, please refer to your HTML contents again, all of you. I think you have forgot, of course, I don't want technical definitions, but the meaning should not be lost. Yes, one way is linking the pages or going to different resources. That is not the only meaning for hypertext. Hypertext, meta value, what does it mean, meta value? I have given one more clue.
So it describes the text about text, like.
Describes the text about the text, what action should be done. Right. So here, this PHP, basically, this is a server-side scripting language. Scripting means basically your coding language, the set of instructions that are given. So they basically concentrates on the hypertext. And the drawback of this PHP is the scalability, in the sense that if you are having more applications to be running and more number of users are going to access that more applications on that server, then the PHP is going to be having its own limitation. That is a drawback of the PHP. Similarly, you have active server pages. So this is active server pages, basically a Microsoft product. So basically, if you are looking for Microsoft services and Microsoft operations to be carried on, then you have to prefer for this ASP. And of course, Ruby, if you are looking for model view, a controller MVC framework architecture where your business logic and your framework logic and your transactional logics are going to be executed on the web or on a different servers and of different categories, then you can go for this one. So your Node.js and your JS, basically your JavaScripts, which are going to be supported on the browser side itself. So each server side has got its own limitations and it has its own features. So here we have another now something called as you can use your Java also. So we can use our Java programming language. So that programming language which can be helpful for us to prepare your dynamic web contents, and which is very much useful for our compute engines. Means preparation, that framework which will help you to get the requests and process the request and give the responses. So requests and responses using this particular aspect. So this getting the request and the responses of those objects which are coming from various clients and all, that can be easily handled by the Java. So here, what does this Java do is, Java uses something called as servlets. This servlets, so what is a servlet? In software engineering terminology, what do you mean by let? Anybody? I hope you already completed your software engineering. What does let indicate or let denote?
For declaration.
Let for declaration. Oh, no. Any other views, please? Any other views? Let indicates what? In IT terminology, we use this let. Servlets.
Sir, actually, it's a lightweight development server for web applications.
Okay. Any other use, please? Okay, I will give one more clue. Triplets. In the triplets, what is that let, L-E-T indicate, or what does it let corresponds to? What is the meaning of that word let? In simple, direct way, in simple question, what is the meaning of let? So here in this servlets, in this word, serve means basically servicing. Basically, you are doing some kind of service.
Routine.
Sir, and let. Let means so the I'm trying to emphasize the word let here. That's only I'm trying to stress. Yes, Vinod, you said something?
Grouping.
Routine.
No, grouping.
Grouping.
Yes.
Yeah, you are on the track. Now you please tell me what is that grouping corresponds to in that software engineering terms. What is that software component which is very much required? Yes, please.
Module.
Yes. One more term. You are very near to that. Module. Another very relevant term.
Block.
Yes, you are revolving around that block, module, group of items, but not coming to the exact word. More very relevant word here. Okay, I'll give the answer. Component. Component. It is basically let's corresponds to components. So servlets means serve components. Very good. Serve component. What is it? Component. Component means here it can do any work for you. That's what. It can be a service a point. It can be trying to give some responses. In terms of what is the information is available, it will give. If the information is not available, it will compute, it will prepare, and it will have the dynamic nature. It's on its own. So all those group of statements, all the services which needs to be rendered for the requests that are made by the client is done by the Java. So Java advantage is above all those servers, the server programming languages, which you have PHP, which you have ASP, Ruby, and Node.js like this. Above all, the Java servlets features are more robust, more secured. In the sense, secured. The Java itself is a secured. Please remember. So the Java, whatever the Java is there, portability is there, independent nature is there. So all these things, which are very much useful for running your applications on different machines and across the different nets and so on and so forth. That's why servlets through servlets, the dynamic web contents can be prepared easily. Through the help of Java programming language, most clearly. So whenever you try to get this request and prepare this request, so here all this get request and the responses is going to happen with the help of your HTTP request. So since those requests are coming from the client to the server, you are using the HTTP request and the corresponding HTTP. HTTP responses. So this HTTP request and HTTP responses corresponding to that. These HTTP requests and HTTP responses are corresponding to the servlets basically. Since if you are running a Java servlet, means you are running this server components, server Java components, which are trying to correspond to or providing HTTP requests and HTTP responses. Your HTTP get or your HTTP post also are going to be varied here. So here to have this Java servlets, please remember we need to have a particular server here. So that server is basically you can use so this server is basically, we call it as an Apache Tomcat server, which do provide the Java servlets to be running, to be prepared, to be running and to be deployed. So this Apache Tomcat server has the features of all these components to be established, components to be running the various services. And so like other things, you also have something called here, a server which is serving the request. That name of the server is basically your Apache Tomcat server. So that is basically to prepare your servlets. So let us see what are these servlets. And since it is meant for dynamic preparation, and all those other server programming languages has its own limitations and restrictions. So main thing here is, which is not available on the server can also be made available in terms by using your logic or your computational engine with the help of this Tomcat server, that is Apache Tomcat server. So let us have some small discussion on this one. What are servlets? I hope, is my screen visible to you?
Yes.
Yeah. So servlets introduction, basically servlets are a Java program that runs on the server. Please remember. So these servlets will help us to create the dynamic web pages, and servlet technology is used to create web applications. So that resides at server side and generates dynamic web pages. So those web pages which are not there can be easily prepared, it can be created, and the dynamic web pages can be updated, it can be upgraded, and it can be passed on. So now coming to servlet technology is robust and scalable as it uses the Java language. That is the most thing. Before to the servlets, we have something called as Common Gateway Interface, CGI. CGI helps us to prepare those dynamic web pages. In the olden days, please remember, this is I'm talking about olden days. You should have some little bit idea on that, because some of the servers do have this CGI features and CGI implementations. Still, it is required, of course, for not very sophisticated. So many applications have now moved from this CGI. We'll come back to that later, but just for your information that you need to have. CGI is also a scripting language, was used as a server-side programming, but there were many disadvantages of this technology. So here, there are many interfaces and classes in the servlet. If you are going to use this servlet programming application, that API, application programming interface, has got something like the servlet itself, generic servlets. You have HTTP servlets, you have servlet request, and you have servlet response. So all this, that's what I was trying to mention to you. So your HTTP requests and HTTP responses, all this comes from your servlets. So that particular thing that we need to understand here, how this is going to be made useful for us. So let us see what is a servlet. A servlet can be described in many ways, depending on the that's what the application is. Servlet is technology used to create web application, that is in very simple terms. Servlet is an API that provides many interfaces and classes, including documentations. Servlet is an interface that must be implemented for creating any other sub-servlets. So servlet is a class that can extend the capabilities of the servers and respond to the incoming request. It can respond to any type of that's why please underline the word, it can respond to any type of request. That's what I was trying to tell you here. So whatever the request that a client is sending the request, it will try to respond. That is the logic, that is the advantage for this. May I know for which type of applications these servlets and this server-side programming is going to be very much useful? Nowadays, everybody uses this, in fact. Yes, please. For which type of applications these servlets are going to be mostly useful for us?
Interactive
applications on the web,
like WhatsApp, Facebook.
Please remember now, whatever you are using, Twitter, WhatsApp, Facebook, not only social networking, your e-commerce websites, all this, they have all come from that technology only. In fact, of course, they are advanced. Now what they are using is an advanced technology, but in the earlier days, I am talking about some 15 to 20 years back almost. I'm talking about in terms of 2001, 2002, this particular period. Of course, 2001 to 2007 and 2008, during this particular period, the servlets have gained a lot of importance. So nowadays you are seeing all this social networking, e-commerce websites and banking transactions and all is happening very effectively because of that servlets technology only, in fact, in one way. Because we don't know how which user, how he is going to ask, what he is going to request, what clients are to be, means what clients request will be there. So you need to prepare for yourself, for your business operations effectively to run. So the servlets are going to be very much handy for us. The servlet is a web component. That's what, see here, servlet is a web component. Component is the right word. You need to look into this component that is deployed on the servers to create dynamic web pages. That's why serve means serving those components for whatever the requests that are made by the clients. So here, that's one more diagram you can see very clearly. So the request which is coming from the client to the server, and the server, if the server doesn't have the direct information, response is generated at the during the runtime, and that response is again sent to the client. So this simple diagram I was trying to explain to you through that particular thing. Please remember, it need not be only a web server. This server is going to be connected to another, it is going to be connected to other servers like your database server, so that your database servers can also fetch some data depending on the user request, and it can prepare and try to respond to that. So request and response through URL. So how this request from the client to the server comes. So let us have some small understanding here. Servlets are Java objects which respond to HTTP requests. Please remember here, servlets are Java objects. So here, these, what are the servlets? HTTP requests. For whatever HTTP request comes, the responses to that HTTP request goes through this HTTP responses. That HTTP responses are nothing but servlets only. Please remember. The other name for servlets is HTTP responses to HTTP requests. Servlets may return data of any type, but they often return HTML most of the time. Servlets are invoked through a new URL. So if you see this URL with the www.whatever.somehost.com/servlet/the servlet search word and the corresponding parameters, the HTTP parameters that you specify it. So on the URL itself, you can specify the servlets and its corresponding values. What servlets do? Servlets, just they handle the requests that are sent by the clients. That's what I'm repeatedly saying. So handle the data and as well as the requests sent by the users. So create and format results, send results back to the users. So whenever some request comes the client to the server, that server is trying to prepare the results, prepare the responses based on the request of the users, and so on and so forth. So coming to who uses the servers, as I told you, now also some of these big giants servlets are useful in many business oriented websites. So eBay, Amazon, and other things already are using these things. So history, if you look to the history a little bit, just to give you the idea, CGI, Common Gateway Interface, which was a very old technology. And now, because why it is old, let us see here. So what happens when request, when you are, and the responses are coming through a server, a servlet. So when you are, see, please look here. So can anybody infer what is the meaning of this diagram? Please tell me.
Each request served by a thread. I mean, for each thread, server create one thread.
Okay. What does it mean?
Threads are the lightweight process, so of course it will be efficient.
And yes. So basically, yes, you are on the track now. Now see here carefully. This server, whatever you are, is basically you are trying to prepare is nothing but it is a container. It is nothing but a container. for your servlets. So here, what is meant by a container? Of course, anything that it contains, it is holding something there. The holding for what? Holding for various servlets. So here, this at the server side, you have a small compute engine. The compute engine is nothing but basically that compute engine is what you are going to look for something called as a container. So this compute engine is also known as a container for doing so many other things. So that's what I just put the words here, a compute engine or a container, both means the same here. So if you look to this diagram, what you understand here is you are getting several requests. So many clients means so many requests are coming. All these requests are coming to your web server. That is what your server, which is located at some other point. So all that request, if there are unknown requests, so each one, the request is given to the thread and the threads are now working on the preparation of those HTTP responses, basically the servers, the servlets. Now this, when you do this kind of processing, your processor, the CPU, the processor means the CPU here, the CPU which is present on this web server, that is basically, it is a CPU, the load on that CPU is very less if you are using the threads concept, and the thread is already governed means it is already held by the, for each and every request you prepare a thread, that is what the container is going to do, and the thread is going to do its task on the servlets, and the servlet will prepare the response and give it back basically. So while happening this process, the server servlet request, the CPU load is very less. That is the thing here, the point to be noted here. So advantages, there are many advantages of servlet over CGI. The web container creates the threads for handling the multiple requests to the servlet. Threads have a lot of benefits over the processors, such as they share a common memory area, which is lightweight, cost of communication between the threads are low. So that's what they share, a common memory area, the memory has been shared, and they are lightweight, so you are going to have a less process. So servlets advantages, if you see, they are efficient, they are convenient, they are powerful, portable, all this basically because of the Java features itself. So if you look to the CGI, you see the processor load here. What does the CGI do? Common gateway interface. So server requests are coming. So for each request, there is going to be a separate shell, separate memory, and separate processing capability should be given. So like this, each HTTPD, the server request that you get it, which is going to have other programming to be performed, and there cannot be done very efficiently because the server processor load on the server itself is very high. If more request comes, obviously the server is going to be down. So those were the olden days, common gateway interface, if you were going for this type of architecture. That's a CGI architecture basically. The disadvantages, there are many problems. If a number of clients increases, it takes more time for sending the response. For each request, it starts a process, and web server is limited to start processes. So it uses a platform dependent language, C or C++ or Perl. Perl is the most scripting language for your CGI, basically. So if you come to Java servlets, means our servlets programming now onwards, we will try to look into this aspect. So Java servlets, as well as the later we will continue for the next week, the JSP. Okay, before going to the next week, one point I forgot to ask you all. Next week we are I'm planning to conduct the minor 2. Okay, is it okay? Anyway, I will send a mail to all once you, those students who are in this session, if you give go ahead indication, then I will send a mail to all of them. Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
So we the syllabus for this minor 2 will be already mentioned in the beginning of the, when we have resumed our class online teaching learning process, I already told you. So here basically we are going to up to cover up for today. We have just request interface, response interface. Up to here we have covered. So up to here the syllabus will be there for the minor 2. So coming
starting onwards, sir.
Starting means which starting?
Unit 1, from unit 1.
No. Only unit 4 and unit 5.
Okay.
Unit 1, 2, 3 already we had in minor 1, if you remember.
Yes, sir.
So in unit 5, I am going to cover up to till here this particular topic. And unit 4 also, we are already covered up to this particular, I think, most likely manipulating attributes, utility methods. So we have not covered the Ajax with jQuery. That is the only thing. So the jQuery commands, which we, before the before there was a break, we covered up to the dome with the jQuery. So those are that topic and the Java programming. Of course, the Java programming includes packages, exception handling, database using JDBC, multi-threading, and introduction to servlets. That's what you are doing. So I'll be covering up to this particular point, response interface, and up to this. So after the minor two, we have 2 weeks. So 1 week I'll be discussing the JSP. And another week, I will be discussing the remaining part of jQuery with Ajax. So that's the plan of completing the syllabus. But anyway, we have 3 weeks from now onwards. I suppose you have 6th is there. You have 6th is there, you have 13th is there, you have 20 is there. Okay. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
So yes, 6th, 13 and 20 as per the schedule of the timetable. So next week we'll plan for this. So after the test is over, anyway, I'll continue and I will go for this JSP. And after the JSP is over, we will go for the jQuery and Ajax. So that completes the syllabus. But anyway, next week, I will send the mail to you all now in this session only. So is it okay to have it on that next week for all of you on Tuesday?
Yes.
Tuesday, yes. At the maximum 1.5 hour only you'll have the test. Hello. Yeah, somebody is trying to say something. Hello.
1.5 hours, sir?
Yes, Vinod, can you please speak loudly?
So what are you saying, sir, about timing? 1.5 hour?
1.5 hour, 90 minutes.
Okay.
See, our Tuesday session is 3 hours.
Yes, sir.
So out of 3 hours, you are supposed to give the answers and submit it within 1.5 hour.
It's objective type question, or we have to make programs like.
Sorry.
Objective type question, sir.
No. I will tell you. I will give the details on the mail.
Okay.
Because this is an online test, I know most of people, you can search it on the internet and try to find answers and everything. All sorts of things will be there. So of course I will tell the what questions and what type will be there, but I will not tell what are those questions, sir. How the questions will be there, I will give the mail to all of you. Just hold on, just for another half an hour you hold on, I will just tell. Let me just complete this topic for today, introduction to servlets, then I'll get back to you. Yeah, any other queries? Just hold on, because I want to just inform you that I just interrupted the session here. So let us complete this. So what softwares do you require for you to run the Java servlets? So usually we need to have Java server pages. That is what we are looking for, those pages which are going to be dynamically created. So you need to have a servlet capable server. So you can use the Apache Tomcat server. So once you install your Apache Tomcat server, let me just show you. So if those are not installed, please make an installation of Apache Tomcat server. I'm just showing you here. So the servers, yes, here. Just hold on, it's trying to pick up. Yes. Yes, so here at present it is been stopped. I just run it and let me just check. Yes. Yes, so it is running now. Yes, started and it is synchronized. So here, like this in Eclipse, you need to install your Apache Tomcat server. Either you can run like this directly, or you can also run through your Oh, okay. AMP server is running here. Let me.
Sir, I think you have to mention the port address.
Yes, yes. One second. Let me just stop the AMP server itself. Yes. And the port number is, if I remember correctly, it will be. Yeah, 9080, a port number. I just forgot. Okay, I have not given 8080. Can anybody tell me why 8080 I have not given?
Conflicted with some other app.
With some other, here you can see that some other is nothing but here.
Oh, okay.
There is an Apache here. Apache server is different from Tomcat. Apache is the company name, okay? So don't confuse, this is simply a web server, Apache server. But this is a Tomcat server, it is an enterprise edition server, please remember. So of course, if you are getting like this, means yes, it's running, Apache Tomcat is running, 404. Don't worry, what is, see here it says Apache Tomcat 9.0.48. Maybe you have a latest version of 10 or 11, I think. So this is a little bit older version, Apache Tomcat. So it is running. So you just make sure that it is installed with, and now like this, you can check it from your side also. I'm just stopping it. Yes, so now once again, once it stops it, then again you can run it and check it. It's stopping Tomcat version 9 server at localhost. This is what I'm just stopping here. Okay. So just install it and make it ready. It's for the next three days, you are going to see the JSPs. Of course, 2 days, of course. So that will be useful for you to practice. So the packages for the servlets. So you, in your Java program, you need to have javax.servlet and javax.servlet.http, because all your requests and responses go through your HTTP request and HTTP responses. So we'll be using these two packages, servlet and HTTP, in addition to the other packages for your programming. So Java servlets have been created and compiled just like your other Java classes. Similar things, you can see one example here. So here, what you have is the normal post and the get methods. Instead of that one, you have something like HTTP post and HTTP get methods, that is in terms of do post and do get methods. So under HTTP, there are two methods available for sending parameters from the browser to the web server. They are basically your post and get methods. So these are the two methods that you use it. And do you know the difference between get and a post method? Can you please recollect it? Yes, please. What is the difference between get and a post? Of course, I'll give the clue. Already we had an earlier discussion. One supports less parameters, other supports more parameters. One is less secured, other is more secured. Which is less?
Any data we want to transfer to server, it is shown in URL, if it is in get method. Post method, data is hided, which we send.
Yes. Using post method, data is hided, that is secured, so that nobody can see what is being transferred there. And post method also supports more parameters. More parameters you can send it. So that's what you can see it here. So the do here, but when you're using the servlets, you have something called do get and do post. That's what you have a method called do get, and you have a method called do post. Of course, these parameters, once you are acquainted to the programming of this, you will know what are those parameters. Basically, your request and response. That's all. HTTP servlet request, HTTP servlet response. That's all. Same way, do post, HTTP servlet request, and HTTP servlet response. And sometimes, if you are unable to perform this communication, your IO exceptions, those are the throw servlet exceptions or an IO exception in your method. So, you are handling this. So here you just see the get method again. So the get method, you are sending the URL, the parameters along with the HTTP protocol. So the request headers are this, the host, the user agent, the accept, the language, the encoding style, character style. Similarly, the post method, you will get the post method here. So the parameters are not there. The message body, this is been encoded in the sense that it has been hidden. Those parameters, you cannot see it here. If you see the difference between this do get and do post, of course, basically the get and post only. So the request contains only the request line and HTTP, whereas the post method contains the HTTP body also, the values, the entire body. You can just see the differences and you just let me know if you are having any doubts on this one. So the servlets code, of course, all the servlets are written in the Java using the Java programming language. So this implements the JavaX servlets, the servlet interface itself. If you see a simple example here to get the counter values, so you write a class simple counter which is extends the HTTP servlet, and when you are extending, it means HTTP is the servlet is the base class. So the base class HTTP servlet is been used here. Of course, when you're using this class, the corresponding packages are also to be imported. And you are writing do get method. Do get method has two parameters. One is request, another is your response. And you are going to set the content type, and you are just writing the output to the print writer, that is out object, a count value. And that count value is going to be out.println. Can you tell me what is the difference between this println and the previous println's which we have seen earlier? Can anybody tell me the println that is, are you able to see my screen, please?
Yes, sir, able to see.
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
able to see.
Yeah, what is the difference between system.out.println and this out.println? Yep. Any idea? System.out.println. System. Your actual system. There also you write out.println, but here we are not writing system. System.out.println is basically to the standard output device or to the console or the system that we are going to use. Console of the system. System.out.println you are using to the console, whereas here we are using to, is it not console or is it something else? Hello. Yes, please.
It's in the response in the web page we are writing.
It is there. I did not hear it properly. Can you please tell me?
I mean, we are writing here in the response object or in the web page.
Response object or to the window. Then what is the difference then?
So the place is the different. In that system.out.println, we are writing the output in a console. And
yes.
Here the output is printing in the browser window or that in the response.
That is to the standard output device. System.out. Out is an output device object only, there is no doubt. But here we are writing something called, you have created an object variable out. See here carefully, you have created an object variable out of print writer type that is equivalent to response.getWriter here. RES is the response you get it. The response that you get it from the server, you are going to use it, the value on to be carried forward to the out variable. So that can be that will be displaying the responses as the count value, which is coming from the server. So now let us see main concepts of servlet programming. Of course, every servlet has its own life cycle, and you can multiple client requests can be made use of. It tries to save the each user request, and the server communication do happen through HTTP request and HTTP responses. And of course, you can call through various servlets by the container to process those data requests. And you have different request attributes and resources. And of course, it also supports multi-threading so that multiple requests can be served for many number of users. So the servlet lifecycle is all controlled by the container in which, that is basically the server engine in which you are going to make use of. So it will have its initialization, service, and destroy. Initializing, the server is getting initialized, and the service is the request which is coming from the server, which is coming from the client. And once the service has been completed, then it is going to be, the servlet is going to be destroyed here. So that's what you get it here, the life cycle of the servlet, initialization, the service, the request, and destruction. So unload the resources so that other request responses can be made use of. So just a small information here, the server is going to be used with the init method. So we'll see in the next programming how that init method is going to used once for your running the program, then the service method, which is serving the request and all. So these are the programming snippets that will just help you to prepare for your program and run. So we'll see in the next class the execution of this one. Servlets, after that we'll move on to GSP. Of course, to the server, we need to have a web server. That's what I told you, the Apache Tomcat web server, Java Development Kit. And if you want to have an integrated runtime environment with various microservices to be transferred upon, you can use the NetBeans too, but NetBeans is not required as much. So this is just some browsers and the programming software tools that are required here. So you can download the Apache Tomcat from the official website, and you can start running these various servlets on this particular URLs. So once you run the program, you will come to know. Then of course, this is a little bit older style. You have this Apache Tomcat 9 and 10 in the latest versions. So that's it. So let's next week we'll see how this we write the program, how the request and the servlets are prepared from this container, and how they are given the responses to the client. A small programs we'll see it, and that will wind up our session. So let me just upload these materials and also send a mail to all of you. Let me just complete the task so that I will not be behind of that. So where am I? Yes. Yep. I have sent the mail, of course. Hello, am I online? Yes, Tawab, are you able to hear me?
Online. Got the mail, sir.
Yeah. So let us complete that activity. If you have any queries, any doubts before the exam, you can ask me.
Sir, this is any major exam you have or just these two minor?
What, Tawab? Can you please repeat?
I mean, sir, any major you have, major exam, or just these two minor?
You are asking whether major exam is there or only this minor? Is that your doubt? Hello.